Hi, this is Nikki Woods, and we are going beyond the studio with attorney and St. Louis resident Gloria McCullum. We're going to talk about the Ferguson situation, which seems like kind of a lame word to use considering all that's going on, but absolutely want to know what recent developments are, you know, what is being done with the killer of Michael Brown, and how is justice going to be brought about in that situation. But then also, how are we going to continue? How are we going to heal? And where do we go from there? Hi, Gloria. How are you?
Hi, Nikki. How are you?
I'm good. We'll tell them later that we went to high school together. We'll save all of that for later. Let's talk about what you're saying is no justice in Jericho. Tell us what your experience has been as a practicing attorney in Ferguson and, you know, the surrounding St. Louis areas. Give us a little bit of background.
Okay. Yeah, Nikki, I have been an attorney for quite some time, in excess of 15 years in the state of Missouri. And we have experienced, you know, just a constant stream of racial profiling, harassment, you know, police brutality. This is just a pot that has been boiling for in excess of 40 years. I know prior to the late 60s, it probably was even worse than that.
But yeah, I heard, and I didn't know this. I mean, you know, obviously we went to school together, so I'm from St. Louis too, for those of who are not aware. But I didn't know that Ferguson was considered a sundown town, which meant that it was a predominantly, if not all, white town. And at sundown, all the black people knew that they had to be out of Ferguson. And I got that information from a historian. So that kind of sets up the racial makeup of Ferguson.
Well, you know, now that you say that, I have never heard it called, you know, that per se. But in terms of when you go through Ferguson, you know, you have to go, you have to be very careful. When you go to court, you're going to see all African Americans in there. You will not see a diverse crowd in the courtroom. And the problem there is that, you know, they pull people over and there's just this history in Ferguson and many of the surrounding municipalities where they're just known for pulling people over. I've been pulled over right around the corner from where this incident happened. It wasn't Ferguson police, but it was St. Louis County police for absolutely no reason. You know, so you're victims of racial profiling just because of your color. It doesn't matter about your gender, you know, or anything like that. But it's kind of a rule out there, you know, that someone's watching you.
Right. So how do we, and it seems like things have gotten a little bit better. It seems like we'll have some days where there's, you know, people are able to protest and show their emotion and they're upset at what they see as an injustice in Ferguson. And then there are other days where, you know, it's not peaceful at all. How do we get this situation under control? I know the funeral of Michael Brown is Monday, so we can expect that it's going to be a very emotional time for a lot of people. How do we get this situation under control?
Well, you know, Nikki, I think one of the biggest complaints I hear, and I'm representing some of the looters who've been charged with burglary and people who have been hit with rubber bullets and things of that nature. Some of the things that I'm hearing is that there are people who are out there and they're peacefully protesting. Mm-hmm. And the word needs to get out that if you need to come through to give medical assistance to someone two blocks away, make an announcement. Don't just come through and start throwing smoke bombs on people. They're not telling people that they need to get through. So they're turning, in essence, what is a peaceful protest into a conflict, because they'll just come through and all of a sudden, you know, say that someone has been injured two blocks away. They'll just come through a peaceful crowd and just start throwing smoke bombs. And people are saying, we were peacefully protesting and all of a sudden they just started bombing us.
Right.
So what needs to happen in essence is that they need to be more more professional in their tactics.
No, and I think that we looking in, because we're not actually there on the ground in Ferguson, I think that we get that. But I think one of the things that our listeners especially are really quick to send to us via text messages and social messages is that there's not a big enough distinction between protesters and looters. And that a lot of the people that are coming in and looting are not in any way, shape, or form involved or associated with the protesters, and that often it's people that are not even from Ferguson, they're not from the surrounding cities, they are indeed sent by organized anarchists to cause trouble and to put a criminal spin on things that probably shouldn't be there and especially shouldn't be associated with the peaceful protesters.
Right, that's correct, Nikki, and you know, I wouldn't doubt that. Unfortunately, there are some people that can be manipulated. There are people who have no mind of their own. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, they come in all races, ages, and colors. You know, the problem for us pretty much is, you know, there are people who are trying to organize and do this in the right way. And then you have those people who are just taking advantage of the situation. And that has happened since the beginning of time. Yep. You know, an opportunity to come up, an opportunity to steal. You know, we do not advocate that. There are people out here who we're trying to tell them the right way to do it. You know, we're providing information for them and trying to educate them, but at the same time, it's a chance to have a big party for a lot of these youngsters because they don't understand. You know, people have suffered for you to have an opportunity to have credibility. And you set us back when you go out there and you start clowning in the streets, fighting, breaking in buildings. That is not the way. As Tupac said, if you want to take an idol and you want to listen to what he had to say, he said, learn how to think ahead and fight with your pen. You know, stop all of this foolishness. You know, I know there were situations where violence has erupted where we don't know why it started or whatever, but, you know, I wouldn't doubt the fact that people are actually sending these people in to be a catalyst to these kind of situations.
So what about Darren Wilson, who is the police officer that killed Michael Brown? I mean, they haven't brought him to justice. They haven't charged him with anything. And a lot of people, including Tom, have said, well, if they just arrest him and then go through the judicial process, I mean, maybe that'll bring some calm to the situation, that people are really just upset that this man is still walking free. He's still being paid as a police officer, even though he is not allowed to be on active duty. Where are we with the charging of Michael Brown? Well, I mean, of Darren Wilson, I'm sorry, in the Michael Brown killing.
I'm told today that the grand jury is convening in St. Louis County. I also heard a rumor, and I don't know if it's true, but if you hear it subsequently, and it did happen this way, let me just tell you, in the history of St. Louis County or the state of Missouri, I have never heard. Now, the rumor is I've never heard of a defendant or a person who is potentially a defendant being brought in before a grand jury. I've heard of a witness who is a victim to a crime being brought in. So they may be trying to bring him in from that angle. But because of the nature of the incident, where we don't really have Mike here anymore to tell us what actually happened that day, and there's speculation that this officer pulled this guy in the car, and maybe Mike was fighting for his life because he thought he was about to be dragged at that point. Whatever the case was, if they're going to put the spin that they normally do on it, they're going to try and say, you know what, this officer is the victim, even though he's the person that starts the fight. And many times that's just the way it goes. And it has been the case many times for cases that I have tried where the police have jumped out, they beat people up, they've grabbed people, they started fights. And then when it comes down to the accountability part, they want to try and justify it with what I call the George Zimmerman defense, saying, hey, he's trying to attack me. So I think that they're bringing him in as a witness to try and get around the fact that, you know, you normally don't bring defendants before the grand jury. It's the grand jury and the state's attorney. And so where do we go from here? You know, I think the biggest issue for us is we're going to try and see if they're going to hold this officer accountable. He needs to be held accountable like any other person would be in a criminal situation. We got this whole process of delay, deny, derail. First they deny it. Then they delay the investigation. And then they try to derail the investigation by pointing the finger from the assailant to the victim and saying the victim is in fact the assailant. They do it every single time from a civil standpoint because they don't want to be liable for any damages if they injured the person, and also, you know, from a criminal standpoint.
All right. Well, we obviously have our eye on this situation, and we appreciate you and everybody else that's on the ground in Ferguson fighting for justice, and indeed those around the country and around the world who help to continue to spotlight these kinds of incidents, because this is not the first, it will not be the last, but maybe this is a chance for us to really get some justice and start setting precedents, you know, that we bring these people, you know, before a jury of their peers, and we hold them accountable. So I thank you, Attorney Gloria McCollum, for staying with us and sharing your story.
Thank you so much.